glory and power and might and dominion and dominion be to you. And all glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you, Lord. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you, Lord. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you, Lord. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion. You're the God of all creation. 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 We give you praise. Oh, we give you praise. Oh, we give you praise. We give you praise. You're the God of all creation. Shout the Lord. Oh, you're the God. Power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you, Lord. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you, Lord. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. Honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you, Lord. All glory and power and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. All glory and honor and power and might and dominion be to you. Jesus. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. And we love you, Lord. We worship you, oh God. Our God, and we love you, Lord. With all our heart and soul, mind, we love you, Lord. Oh, eternal God, we worship you. And we love you, Thank you. place right now. Holy Spirit, glorify Jesus. Jesus, make known to the Father. Let everybody in this place come to know how good it is when the rivers flow. Oh, Jesus. And I love you, and I worship you. You make me feel like no other can do. All this joy in your presence, unspeakable, what a delight. What a delight to speak with you. Let me forever behold you. Let me forever just stand and give you praise. There's nothing other I want to do throughout eternity than gaze on you. So captivated by you, Lord Jesus. So wonderful the things you do. Jesus, our majesty. Thank you. that is within me sings your praise, sings your praise. You are the Lord, oh, you are the Lord, oh, you are the Lord, oh. You are the Lord of all. You are the Lord of all. You are the Lord.
Get a sail. God, you are in all your ways. How wonderful, how marvelous, oh God, you are to me. How wonderful, how marvelous, oh God, you are in all your ways. How wonderful, how marvelous, oh God, you are to me. And I give you praise by your Holy Spirit. And I give you praise by the supernatural one. And I give you praise for everything you're doing and everything. And I give you praise by your Holy Spirit. And I give you praise by the supernatural one. And I give you praise for everything you're doing and everything you've done. Get a city, little room. Get a city. Oh, how wonderful your name, oh God, in all the earth. Oh, how wonderful your name, oh God, in all my life. Oh, how wonderful. say, Lord, gird your sword upon your side, come ride prosperously. Now look at all the armies of heaven as they follow thee. And oh, how wonderful, marvelous, oh God, is your name in all the earth. And oh, how wonderful, how marvelous, oh God, is your name to me. And I give you praise for everything you are. And I give by the power and your strength that you've given, in a day we slew 10,000 of our enemies. In the power and the strength, oh God, you give it to me. We stripped them of their arms. Hallelujah. There is no sword found in our hand, but 5 stones and a sling is all we need. Our God of hosts, we come against every army of the enemy. Look at what you've done. Hallelujah. Yeah, they stand at the altar. When you're walking with the Lord, all you need is a jawbone of a donkey, and that will do. You'll take on all their spears and swords and mighty weapons they will never do. Hallelujah. Oh, for me and the Lord, you and the Lord, I promise you it's a majority. More are with us than are with them. Hallelujah. 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 You know, a long time ago, I'd set up a mic, you know, to let people come up and just sing, you know. But, you know, I'll tell you right now, you have freedom. You can do it right there. You might not have a loud voice, but it's okay. We can kind of get quiet to listen to you. One word of encouragement. If you don't have a good voice, don't try. But you can rap or something. Oh, I love you, Lord. Oh, I love you, love you, love you. Oh, I love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the authority of your Holy Spirit, the ability. You know, we go into places where, you know, where Pashtuns are, other people from, you know, various different radical groups, all, you know, various different sorts of ISIS. That would be the best way for us to describe it. People like the Taliban, others. And we just watch God just touch their lives, because we carry something that's so beautiful, so disarming. I mean, people who spent their whole life, I mean, in war, like the Kurds, who spent their life in war since they were 12 years of age, you know, just crazy stuff. And watch the power of God touch them, set them free. I mean, you don't have any idea what so many folks have been through and the crazy that they've lived in every day of their life. And here you are sitting over in this place called a land of peace and prosperity. You got nothing really to have to deal with for the most part. And Father, and so there's really that much less of things that should be hindering you.
from receiving all that God has for you. You know, about in 2019, we had it all set up to go in from Armenia into Turkey and then over across the border into Iraq, just to, because the Lord is so laid on our hearts what was going on with the Kurds and the Kurdish people. And, you know, they've been so disenfranchised of their land since the Ottoman Empire, and just so many crazy things going on. They had so many promises that were never kept. You know, we countries just use people like that for their own purposes, and they end up totally devastated with nothing. And we know what God the Holy Ghost would bring to change a person's life, take them from such devastation, such heartache, such unbelievable crazy that nobody in this place, maybe a couple, can imagine what it's like to live out your life every day in such, you know, fear, torment, war, highest adrenaline you can possibly imagine. And then by the time you're 17 years old, you've been fighting for four or five years. Can you imagine that? No. But nonetheless, I want you to know that there's a power of the living God, the wonderful, glorious person of the Holy Spirit comes in and does an operation on the very heart and mind of a person. Take all that stuff away. Fill them with a glorious vision of heaven. This wonderful place of living in His goodness and His mercy, His love and His joy, His peace, supernatural ability. You know, I remember, you know, we just had Britt here last Sunday, and I remember when he told a story about when, well, it wasn't Britt, I can't remember exactly who told me, but David Hogan, I don't think, told me. But I can't remember who did, but nonetheless, he went into Mexico, where they're at in Mexico, which is a bit further south than the border, believe me, probably about, I can't remember exactly, 4 or 5 hours, whatever. But at any rate, the folks that were there, the contra-revolutionaries, they came down and were going to kill him. You know, they had their machine guns all loaded up. And he just grabbed the barrel of one of the guns that they were trying to tell him he had to leave and, you know, trying to intimidate. He just put the barrel in his mouth. We first said, fire away, stuck the barrel in his mouth. And he's a big guy, strong. And they pulled the trigger and nothing happened. And everybody else started pulling their triggers and nothing. Firing pins weren't working. And they all became his deacons. I mean, we just have something on our side that we can't even begin to imagine until we put it to the test. Because God is absolutely real. He's absolutely on our side. He'll absolutely defend us. He'll absolutely keep you. I mean, I promise you, He'll absolutely change everything about your life. I don't care what devastation you've been through. There's not a person in here started fighting wars at the age of 10 years old, blowing people's heads off and dealing with the rest of the mess. You haven't. I mean, that's just for me, that's the craziest you could ever be, having to live every day to kill someone. Not a day of peace, not a day without war. And I know some of you had some serious struggles in your life. You've been abused, you've been hurt, you've been had rejection. But you can't even imagine on the other side of the world what's going on right now. And I just pray that somehow you grab a hold of the reality that God would not only change them and help them and transform their lives, but it change you and transform your life. You've never been through this kind of crazy. And I know you've been through some heartaches and some tough things, but today, in Jesus' name, that becomes erased from your life. It no longer controls you, rules you. You're not a prisoner of your past. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Right now, in Jesus' name, everything changes. You know, you can be seated, but try not to get, kids, just stay for just a second. Just stay. Well, maybe they should go. Maybe they should go. I woke up one morning and the Lord told me to go into a place called Mbaba. And supposedly Westerners, nobody but crazy fundamentalist Muslims go into Mbaba. And I went in and, you know, you're supposed to kind of dress up like they dress up because you don't want to stand out. I kind of was dressed like this. But it's like nobody saw me. But I went there because there was about 500 prostitutes that a friend of mine had gathered together. They'd all been They'd all been born again, at least they had a confession of being born again. But can you imagine that when you're just a little girl, they take you in that kind of a place because you're not Muslim on your license, on your driver's license, you're, as it were, you're a Christian. Muslim girls can't be prostitutes. Only Christian girls can be prostitutes. And they take you from a very young age. You're abused every day of your life. Can you imagine that? And the Lord told me to go there and minister to them this wonderful baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire. There's over, the last account that I had, there was over 5,000 girls. They multiplied by 10 times. And, you know, to see those girls and the beauty of transformation upon their face. To look, because, I mean, you can just tell, you look at a person's face, you can see purity or you can see immorality. And to look at all of those faces so transformed by the name of Jesus Christ and the purity upon their face. The power of God came upon them. Oh, I'm going to tell you right now, He's so real. He changes everything about our life. People, we want you to believe in the reality of a miracle called the new creation. I mean, there's some people that are in here right now that can tell you about some radical wild lives. But you know what? There's nothing so wonderful as the testimony of I had this radical wild life. Totally abused in every way, and none of that matters and none of that affects me anymore because I'm so transformed, I'm so changed, I'm so everything like Him. The impurities of the past, the hurts, the abuses of the past don't even exist in my mind. It's like some nightmare I had. I could kind of remember it, but it wasn't me. Ooh, hallelujah. Come on, Father, I'm telling you right now, Father wants to take you into a realm of freedom. He wants to take you into a realm of an abundance of life. Ah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, I've watched Christians, though. I mean, my uncle fought in the Battle of the Bulge, and that was a terrible, terrible. I mean, they just like, what? If you ever read about that, they went through such incredible, you know, torture of the mind. And for that, that was one of the craziest battles of World War II. And he never got over it. You know why he never got over it? Because he never gave it all over to Jesus. He never did. He would go to church, he read his Bible, but he never allowed the Lord to heal what was going on inside. I promise you, the new creation heals everything that's going on inside. But the Lord, there is a qualification for that. You have to be willing to come and let Him work a miracle of change that He describes. You can't hold on to your own life. Sin brings the heartaches. Sin brings all of the memory, you know, the power of darkness, the power of sin on us brings all the memory of the torture, the torment, the rejection, the hurt, all the stuff. I promise you that, is there anybody in here who's never been hurt? Offended, upset, felt abused? No. Everybody has some degree of it. I know yours was the worst ever. There's always worse. It's always worse. There's always a worse disposition, problem, things that you'd have to go through. That I don't care how bad it is. The Lord transform you, change you. Make you a creation, a creature of heaven. Something so wonderful, something so glorious, washes it all, it's glorious, washes it all away. That which medication can't do, that's which, you know, if there was a surgeon that could go in and remove that part of your memory while everything else would continue to work, I promise you it wouldn't still hold a candle to what God would do for you by the power of the Holy Ghost. This wonderful work of the new creation. All I want to do is be able to convince you of that, and what I have to be able to do is bring you to a place where you'll believe that God's word is actually absolutely true, and that if you agree with Him, He'll do this thing for you. He'll change everything about you. You won't live another day in torment. I know some of you went through the education system. That is a dramatic, terrible, you know, you have post-traumatic stress syndrome for the rest of your life. You wake up in the middle of the night thinking, oh no, I missed my final. I know that's the worst trauma you've ever been through. The Lord will heal you. He'll heal you. And those who have been through, you know, a real terrible thing that would cause you to constantly stress out about it, The Lord's here to heal you this morning. Change everything. Got a problem with somebody? He's going to change it. Got a problem with your life and the way things are going right now? He'll make everything new. Everything new. God is so good. He's so wonderful. God is so wonderful. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Where's Elizabeth? Where's the darling? Oh, I guess I'm doing announcements today. I never do good announcements. Even if I had a list in front of me. Am I missing anything, Allie?
We have.
Come on, that thing. Come. You're a substitute.
Hallelujah. Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. We are so glad to have you. I hope you are expectant of signs, wonders, and miracles today. Like Pastor said, everything can change for you today. It's no coincidence that you're here today. God has an appointment for you, and you came to meet with a living God. He is here. You are meeting with Him today. Woo-hoo! We are so excited. So this week, you can be in community all week, because that's what we love to do. We love to be in the community of saints. So on Thursday, if you're in the ages of 13 to 25, you get to be at the Amazing's Pastor Ruth, Pastor Cade. Hallelujah. We have Bible study with Dr. Stuart Graham. I've heard incredible things of what's happening there.
Let me just say something about that real quick. Because what you guys are going to do is you're not going to sit in a room and basically talk about things you've talked about over and again. We're asking Stuart to take it to another level. And let's go see what you can do with what you know. Amen. And then it's okay if you fell, flop, you know, don't make it happen. You just come back and maybe, you know, review what you studied and pray more about it and then come back. So it's not going to be just going and, you know, sit around and ask questions about things that can't be answered. It's just true. Or things that you never aspire to and think, oh, well, I wish I was there then. Oh, God has it for us somewhere in the future. But we want a now gospel.
Amen.
Not a past one and a future one. Someday, overreaching, now.
Yes.
Now is moving and accepting what God says. So Stuart's going to lead people out into the streets, different places. You can go see how many people you can touch. Let God touch through your life. Then come back and get a prayer meeting. Ask questions about why it was that things happened the way they did.
Yes.
And before long, we believe God that you'll come rejoicing, bringing the prisoners that you met and liberated from their prison with you.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. That's so powerful to like learn and then be put into action. We don't just sit, soak and sour. We get the message and we go out. And that's where you guys get empowered by God to see amazing things. If you look around in this house, people were brought in because we went out and we grabbed them, right? We grabbed them and we don't let them go. So right. I love that. Married group, how awesome is married group? Woo! We have so much fun in married group. It is my favorite thing to look forward to. But we are going out this month. We are not going to stay in our house. Why? Because we want to go out. We want to reach people. So every single married person, you are welcome with kids to join us on Friday. We are so excited about this. This is not just the living nativity. This is the entire gospel played out, role modeled to people, and the fruit that has come from people coming to this. How many people have turned back to God and returned to their churches? How many people have repented? How many souls have come to the kingdom just from this living nativity? Has been so powerful, and I want to be a part of it. I want to hook up with people that are going out to seek and save the lost, to bring them in, to see them repent, get right, go back to their home churches, and serve the Lord. So join us, please, on Friday, December 22nd. Again, it's Marrieds with your kids. And invite your neighbors, your friends, your family, everyone. So you got to come. You got to come and watch what the Lord's going to do in and through you and just inviting them. Amen. And I think that is it.
That's awesome. You know, I think a far more important ministry is for everybody who's not married wants to be married. But we don't have that. But we're praying for you. Hallelujah. Listen, we're so blessed to have every one of you here. We want you to know that we love you and that we're here to help you. And you've got to let us help you. if we don't know what's going on, there's really, you know, the Lord's going to have to come and give us, you know, word of knowledge or, you know, vision or dream. If we want to help, we're here to help. Somebody says, oh, we don't want to bother you. It's not a bother. Oh, Lord, I've got some requests, but I really don't want to bother you right now because I know you're so busy. He's not really that busy when it comes to something that's sincere, a sincere need in our lives. And so we're here. We love you. We're here to help you. We promise you we're never going to leave you. We're not going to kick you out in any way of our lives. We're going to be right here. We're going to challenge you sometimes. It's going to come at you pretty strong. It's going to come at you like a freight train every once in a while. But we're going to stop before we hit. You know, the Lord has given us a not only a vision for the nations of this earth, but for this nation. And Southern California is just as much, if not more, in dire need of the reality of who Jesus Christ is and the authority of Christ Jesus and the working of the Spirit as much as any, and I think really in many respects more than any place in the world. There's a lot of crazy stuff going on in Southern California. And I've got a vision from the Lord. I've just seen it over and again. And in that is I've seen the glory of God come upon every single dwelling, and especially in San Diego County, because that's what the Lord gave us to do. I came to San Diego with the purpose of going to Santa Cruz. I came to San Diego just as stopping off to go surfing on South Cliffs at New Break and a few other places that people tell me is the greatest breaks on the earth and whatever. But I was on my way to go. A very, very wealthy family was going to promote me in music. And ultimately, I stayed here. And it was all God having his way in my life. And ultimately, he gave me this huge vision for this region of the world. And we know it's going to ultimately be fulfilled. God's going to have his way. Amen. That his glory and his presence have come upon every dwelling in this county. There's 197 zip codes in this county. 197 individual, like little individual nations. You know, you don't have to go to the Middle East to go to the Middle East. They're right here in San Diego. You can go to Iran. There's a neighborhood of Iranians, Iraq. You can go to Syria. You can go to Libya. One day we will have a mass evangelism crusade in Benghazi, Libya. Amen. Can you imagine that? Damascus, Syria. Right now, Saudi Arabia is going woke. They're getting ready to launch Disneyland in Saudi Arabia and a whole bunch of other things because the crown prince just wants to be modernized. Things are going to change. Things are going to change. It's crazy. People are going to change in their gowns for some pants and a shirt. They can get rid of their, you know, dress from 2,000 years ago and put on modern dresses. Things are changing. And we're going to see God open up the nations like never before in all of the history of the gospel. It's going to happen. But what God would do right here in this county, and I pray that you'll just let the Lord teach you, talk to you, develop a vision in your heart for a specific zip code. And, you know, you send them out two by two. I want you to have a partner. I don't know that I want a bunch of people crowding up together. You just go find yourself a couple people that are hurting and dying. I don't know. You might have to knock on 100 doors. I don't know. You might have to talk to 100 people, maybe 500 people, but you're going to find somebody that you will be the answer to their prayer. They had just said that morning, God, if you love me, if you're there, please send somebody because I need help desperately. I can't go through another day. And so I want you to just take it to that place called prayer, intercession, crying out to God. For the lost, what Father's going to do is he's going to develop your ability to speak just like him as you talk to him. It's an amazing thing. Prayer is more than the privilege that we have of making our petitions known and our requests known to the Lord. It's where the Holy Spirit teaches us to talk like the Father, to speak with his authority. Because what happens is you might start off and it's just something that's purely mental, purely intellectual, but if you're sincere and true in your heart, there's going to be a divine explosion on the inside of you. The power that framed the universe going to come on the inside of you and begin to speak through you. And from that day forward, when you talk, there's going to be something unique about what you say and about the way you say it. There's going to be a power behind in this. God's power. It's greater than all other power. And then you're going to find out really, truly, that he's with you and that he's in you. And that he comes and presents himself to those that are around you through you. That, what an honor. What a privilege to be able to have that kind of partnership with the living God. And so I want you to agree with me, because I believe that we could plant churches in all 197 zip codes. Could you imagine that? You, somebody said, well, I want to be in the ministry. I got y'all plan right here. I have the whole, you know, career proposal set before you right now. Just take one of those zip codes and watch God go to work through your life and do more through your life than he would ever possibly do through anybody else's life that you've read about or heard about. Britt's life, Britt and Audrey, what God did through them. That wasn't easy. Audrey's father is a pediatrician. She didn't have lack of anything growing up. She meets Britt. He takes her out into a place that nobody goes to. You got to get a machete to get to it the first time and the second time and the third time, every time, because it's just a forest constantly growing. You got to constantly hack your way through to go sleep on dirt floors, eat food that you don't want to know anything about, because the more you know about it, the less you want to eat. Huh? And they gave their life. With nobody there, no one knowing Jesus. They gave their life to see the place totally transformed. It starts with the one, then it goes to a few more, then a few more, then before long. Who knows? There is no ending. Now, of course, with Britt and Audrey, they in Argentina. Britt just sent me a picture of Carlos, one of my dearest friends. It's like a dad to us. I saw him scolding Michael on a picture. My little brother's down there with him, because Michael used to be crusade director for America for Carlos and Aquandia Ministries. And it's just so good to have such great partnerships, see what God is doing. But nonetheless, you know, now Britt and Audrey's leading the charge in Nicaragua. And they stepped in from a place of believing God just for enough, you know, food to take care of just the immediate needs, to now, this past year, they watched the Lord provide over $4 million for Nicaragua and the Crusades. Probably another $5 million for this next year. And if you know anything about them, they don't go raising money. There's just supernatural, miraculous provision. And the Lord does the same thing for you. But you can't just sit in a seat of hesitation, a quandary of uncertainty. Because if you read the Word of God, it should produce within you faith. And I'm going to tell you something that's a precursor of faith. Radical boldness. Amen. Your eyes look like, are you with me? They look like lightning bolts. They're ferocious. Because a boldness takes a hold of you, a confidence, because you're reading a message from your Father that says, this is what I want you to do, and I promise you I'm going to go everywhere with you, and I'm going to do it through you. I'm going to do it with you, but I'm going to do it through you. It's going to be me present with you. I'm going to do this through you. And when you start believing, you really start believing this, you're not going to sit around and theorize anymore. Are you listening to me? Can you imagine science still sitting in a room somewhere theoretically thinking about what might happen if they mix those two reagents together? I was telling a preacher the other day, if science acted like the church, are you with me? We'd still be having square tires pushing carts. Because we haven't been willing to really take it to the extent. Well, not. There have been a few who've been willing to go in the most remote, crazy, hostile regions and see the power of God just change everything about the nation, everything about people's lives. It's happening in the Sudan right now. A woman went into the Sudan. We're in the parts of Sudan where everyone said, if you go there, you will not live 1 week. These are the most radical Muslims on the earth. And what God has done to her life. She has a whole army of preachers now. She started off with zero. Now she has an army of Sudanese preachers. Beautiful. Thousands of people coming into the kingdom. And I'm sure it's more than that. Look, I'm going to tell you this because I want to just help you understand what God wants to do through you. He's not limited anybody. It's just only a few people are going to really believe that he is going to do what he said he will do in his word. And he's made you to be that person. Because we're always thinking about, well, I can't do it. We look at our own, you know, resources, our own accomplishments, or we look at our failures more than we look at our successes many times. We tell people about our successes, but basically are swamped with our failures when no one else is around. The Lord wants to change all that. He wants you to quit thinking about you. Start thinking about how he thinks. Thinking about those things that he's done for you. He wants you to quit thinking about the way you would do things, the way things have happened to you. Start thinking about the way he does things and what happens when he shows up. And if you disagree with me, it doesn't take many. You know, if think about this with me. Think about this with me. I mean, I do this quite often, and I just think, okay, what if we were the first century church? What if we were the 120 that were there on Pentecost Day? Would we have had the same results? Because he's not changed. His power's not changed. That which he's doing is exactly the same today as it was 2,000 years ago. And they were in a far more difficult place of the earth, around a bunch of Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes and people that said, crucify him, away with them. I mean, you can't imagine a harder place to preach. And yet God, when he came and set upon their lives and filled them up to overflowing, supplying rivers of the Holy Spirit, they were swept away with him. There was no religion. There was no Jewish religion. There wasn't quote unquote Christian religion. So this is brand new. We haven't had time to have doubt yet. We haven't had time to have unbelief and try to figure it out. It just all happened. It just swept away in the rivers. God wants to do that right here in San Diego. God to do it right here in Southern California. God to do it through you. But you got to get out of your theoretical laboratories. Out of the mental thing. Your mental. T.L. Osborne says you have no right to preach anything that you cannot actually do. You have no right to declare what God would do if he hasn't done it through you. And it wasn't a threat. It was just like, God will do this through you. All you got to do is just step out. So it wasn't like, you know, eliminating anybody from the army. Just step out. Step out. Amen. Somebody said, well, I knocked on 10 doors and all they did was just tell. You know, you have to get over yourself. Because you may, who knows, they may... Who knows what they'll do? But you don't stop. You don't stop. Only doubt stops. This boldness and confidence of who God is and what God was going to do. Because you go reach out to people over and over and over again, and it seems like that just you're going nowhere. But you don't stop. You're going to get one, and that one is going to be a door to break through. It's the one. I know people on the mission field that spent many years getting the one, and when the one came, it was a breakthrough for the whole nation. Hudson Taylor, he's got a monument built for him in Hangzhou, China, that is still there, made it through everything, the Boxer Revolution, Culture Revolution, made it through everything, through all the reign of communism, even into this day. And he spent his whole life, and he only had one person, but he didn't stop. I mean, can you think about that? He did not let up in a hostile culture that was everything against who he was and what he was preaching. But now, over 350 million Holy Ghost-filled Chinese believers owe him a great debt of gratitude. They owe the gospel brought to their nation by him. And I want you to know it's not going to be that hard for you. Would you just agree with me? Would you start pressing in? You get out of your living room. Get out of your theory. It seems to me like I've watched so many people who really didn't have that much of a knowledge of Scripture. But they took what they knew and they ran with it. And God did great things through them. All you got to do is just believe just a little bit. Go with a little bit of boldness. And he's going to add to it every single day. He'll add to it every single day. There'll be every kind of voice of this world telling you, you can't do it, you can't go there, you can't be this, you can't do that. That's why you don't want to listen to the voices of this world. You don't want to be plugged in so much into that realm of men's thinking. You want to get over here and get plugged into this realm of God thinking. You want to talk to the Lord Jesus Christ, your communication with the Holy Spirit. He'll tell you about what Elijah believed. You want to go and hear what Enoch has to say and his testimony in the scripture and what Moses and what Joshua and the list goes on. What all these folks had to say about God's promise when he said, I will be with you. I will be with your mouth. I will be in your life. I promise you, everywhere you go, I will be there. From Moses to Joshua to Jeremiah, all the way to you right now. Amen. You can't. You're going to have to get past the fear, the trepidation, all that men say the world is, all that you believe, the way it's designed. You know, science, I'll just take clinical science for a moment. They don't believe in this, really, for the most part. Nothing that they account for or believe within the mechanisms of physiology and anatomy has anything to do with spirituality. They removed all of that all the way out of the way and just made you a robot, a human robot. Purely physical, purely mechanistic and mechanical. And now you're just going to buy in on all of that? And you're going to believe that the eyeball works the way that some physiologist said, based upon the anatomy, this is how it works. No, it's far more spiritual than that. And every part of your being is far more spiritual than that. And I'm going to tell you right now, one day God will take it from the ashes and from the dust, and he will speak to it, and it'll be by the Spirit raised up to be you once again. But looking a whole lot better than you look right now. Amen. Hallelujah. It's far beyond anything that men have ever thought or calculated. So why do you want to get stuck in that realm of thinking? It's time to think differently. Amen. People have told you how money and how resources and how provision comes to you. That's the way men do it. They fight and lie and steal and murder and operate in a realm of greed. So that they can have the world that they say that you have to fit into and that this is the way provision works. But I'm going to tell you right now, in the realms of the kingdom of God, by the Spirit of God, it works entirely opposite from that. It doesn't work the same way. And so we want you to come to know that, and we want you to step into it and believe God is with you. Yes. He'll speak through you. The Spirit of the Father will be in you and speak. Yes. Father, just say that. Father, the Almighty God, the Sovereign of the universe, will actually speak through your lips. Matthew chapter 10, Jesus tells us, in that day, don't take thought for what you say, because at the same moment, it will be, you will have the words you're supposed to speak, because it will be the Spirit of the Father speaking through you. The Spirit of the Son is here speaking through us. If we're willing to allow him to be our teacher and our mentor, so we learn how to talk right. Yes. He'll teach us how to think in an entirely different realm. It will spend time with him. He'll teach us how to think right. He'll show us how to be endued every day to put on Christ Jesus. Do you know how many verses of scripture, how redundant God was with this whole concept of put on the Lord Jesus Christ? And it deals with every main issue of our lives in the New Testament. I might be liberated tonight to minister on it, but only for the perspective that you're going to do it. Not, oh, you know, wow, it was an amazing meeting. The presence of God came in. It was so wonderful. I felt more peace than I have all week. There's got to be more than that, people. Praise God for the peace. Praise God for the joy. Praise God for the love. But you have to do something with what God is saying. His word is miraculous. It's powerful. It's living. It's spirit. It's life. But you got to put action to it. Because to believe something is to put action to faith. Faith is a noun. Believing is the verb. It's the action verb. Most of you basically kind of got, you know, in the English language and parsing out a sentence down. Probably a lot better than me. But it's this faith comes by hearing the word. But then if I'm going to be the person that's defined by God as the believer, that means that I heard the word, And then I immediately did something with it. I put it into action. Amen. And what God will always do is something supernatural for you, for me. Yes. Just like Peter saying, if it's you, give me the word. Yes. Faith comes by the word. Yes. He said, it's me, come. And with the word, come to me, suddenly you think about the transformation of thinking that goes on for a fisherman. He had been sinking all his life when he got in the water. He knew exactly what water would do. And now there's waves here too. He moved out of all the realm of his natural thinking and all the realm of his training and all the realm that we are confined in for that interaction with Jesus. And at the word, he had an action of believing in who Jesus is. And what happened was so glorious. We're talking about it 2,000 years later. Hallelujah. You know, there was a time not too long ago. How many of you ever heard of Mel Tari, Like a Mighty Wind? Mel was actually in the church for a while here and come down from L.A., lives up in L.A. Those guys walked across the water in Indonesia because, you know, they were going to a revival meeting. God was moving by his spirit, people getting saved. Liberated from all the crazy stuff that they were involved in, and a storm came, and the river, you know, what was a place that could easily cross became a river. They walked across the water as though it was dry land. Wow. These things still happen today. Amen. Huh? But they're not going to happen sitting in your living room, opening up your Bible, and reading the same thing you read over and again and still haven't done. Don't get me wrong. I'm in the Word. I stay in the Word. I spent the other day. Day before, I spent probably 4 or 5 hours on one single word, because I'm translating the Psalms, and Psalms has some really difficult words in it to understand really what does this mean. What does this word really mean? So I'm in the Word. I'm just going to put the Word to action. I'm going to do these things. And you know what? When I set about to do things in obedience to God, knowing that he's with me and working with me, I'll have all these voices come at me like a storm. It ain't going to work. Oh, no. And this and that and the other thing. I'm just like, no. I start moving. I mean, even the natural. Let me just tell you about a natural. If you've been sitting around being lazy and not doing your exercises, are you with me? And getting out of shape, becoming more unhealthy and more of a diseased state. When you think about, I'm going to get up and run a mile, it don't sound good. It's like you're going to have all kinds of reasons to just sit there on, you know, the backside of your protoplasm. But when you get up and you start moving and you just push through all the why nots and all the pain and all the issues and all the discomfort, you start feeling better. You discover, wait a minute, I can do this. Well, that's just a natural kind of concept, a weak natural concept of what God will do for us supernaturally. Because when we step out with him, there is going to be a surge of divine power in our life that is going to cause us to realize, look, this is going to be every day in my life. It's not going to just be occasionally. Why go through the same problem? Why do you go through the same pain? Right now, I've got my goal set of how far I'm going to ride my mountain bike, how far I'm going to run, what kind of terrain I'm doing this on. I've got my goal set. But I know that if I stop, then I've got to go through the pain all over again. If you stop for a week, you've got to go through the pain all over again. You stop for a month. Oh, my goodness. It's like, especially when you get my age. I'm like getting warmed up to 65 here. The older you get, the harder it is. And just from a natural perspective, people, the same thing happens spiritually. You spend all your life basically doing nothing or very little with what God has assigned you to do, really not taking the word seriously and seeing how far you can go with God working alongside you, with you, in you, through you. I mean, I'm talking about God who can do anything. Are you with me? I'm talking about God, the real deal God, creator of the heavens and the earth. And you just sit around on that for too long, it's going to be harder. It's going to be harder for you to step out. You're going to deal with more of your fear, more of your doubt, more of your unbelief. I'm going to tell you where doubt comes from. It comes from fear. That's where it comes from. You see it back with Peter walking on the water. He took his eyes off Jesus, who is the faith. He's faith. That's where faith comes from. He's it. Faith operates in looking at him, receiving him from him, recognizing what only He can do, and set my eyes on the natural challenges, the waves and the wind. As soon as I set my eyes on the natural physical realm, I just open up the door for fear to come in. And as soon as fear comes in, so does doubt and unbelief. And you can choose actually to just stay there. Obviously, if you're sinking, you know, there's all the alarms are going off. You're about to die. You're gonna cry out. But if you can basically accommodate your couch, the alarms aren't going off. In the natural, what you can hear, see, but they are spiritually. The alarms are going off. You're running out of time to live big for God. You don't get to live big for God. In any other time in your life, like in eternity, like you have the opportunity to live for Him right now. And it's not just making it to church. I mean, praise God, you guys all made it here. There's some trophies, but there's no big trophies. Everybody wants trophies for, you know, not doing anything, for failure. We're not giving out trophies for failure. Wave at me. These trophies mean something. Amen. We're not giving any purple hearts and medals of honor for because you made it through boot camp. Otherwise, it loses its special. It loses its merit, its value. Come on, people. Looky here now. God wants to do great things through you. He wants to do signs and wonders and miracles through your life. There is a partnership that Father's made available for you, and you're going to have to be willing to plow through all of the hindrances of doubts, unbelief, and all the things that men think in order to be able to realize it. And the partnership is that you're co-inheritors right now with Christ Jesus. When God raised up Jesus Christ from the dead and set Him His own right hand, He made provision for you and I to actually inherit all that He Himself, by Himself, accomplished. Authority over all the powers of darkness, over all sin, sickness, and disease. And what happens is so many people that have come to Jesus get compromised with sin, and they lose their power and the authority that was won for them in Christ Jesus. Praise God, there is a place called repentance. Most folks leave it off at confession. And confession never really equates into repentance, because repentance says, I'm not doing this anymore. I'll die first before I commit treason against the Most High. I mean, if you get signed up in the military, the worst thing that you could possibly think about is be a treasonous person. Be another Benedict Arnold. I don't know if he did it or not, but he got blamed. Are you with me? So I'm going to go ahead. Because everybody can track with me. I don't want to be Benedict Arnold in the kingdom of God. Neither do you. I don't want to be treasonous. I want to understand the power and the beauty of righteousness, the power and the beauty of holiness. But all of that is a display of who He is in the earth. It isn't about you sitting around the house making right decisions and doing good. I mean, it's good to sit around the house and make right decisions and do good, but His righteousness and His holiness is about you and I being able to be co-inheritors with Him and stand on this earth and with this partnership, with Him working alongside of us, do everything that He Himself does. So we say, kingdom now. The kingdom of God is here, right now. And it's not just another story, another little book. Muslims got a book, Buddhists got a book, Hindus got a book, everybody's got a book. Some people know their book better than others. But only God's people who move in obedience to Father, in relationship and partnership with the Holy Spirit, have the proofs and have the evidence. You know, when Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, He said, listen to me, I will be with you always, literally. He says, I will be with you every day until the end of the age. Here, look at it. There's a great translation you got right there. Not that one, that one. I hope everybody's reading the translation and help me find any, you know, missing verses. Or half verses. I pray they're not there. I think we got them all. I think it's a whole and complete New Testament. But what we did was, I just said, I'm not flowering this thing up. Tyndale flowered it up. 80% of King James is what Tyndale by himself did. And I don't know where he got half his words. Honestly, I read, it was painful. Try it sometime. Try to read Tyndale's translation of the New Testament. It's difficult. And there are so many words there, like six words, you know, in Greek, and he's now got 30. I'm like, where did you get all this stuff? He formed, 70-80% of the King James, and the Geneva translation, really pretty much the other 20%. And I praise God for all the translations, but I'm focused in on exactly what you said, Lord. And just, I want you to listen. If you have the TOT translation, somebody said, do you have a translation that you would recommend? I said, yeah. There's this translation called the TOT. Britt started reading it. He said, I want a case of these. Where do I order? It's true. If you know the Word of God, I'm going to tell you right now, you can have all your concordances, especially if you have Logos or whatever other Bible software. Just try to come up with a better word. And when you do, let me know, because I want to put it in. Just do the research. Spend the time. I started this really focused in 2002. And we really just pretty much released it this year. And I promise you, I consulted every commentary, every lectionary. I mean, I read things like, as I said, Tyndale, just comparing, contrasting. And so I want you to do it too, but for right now, just look at me. That's why it takes me so long to preach. I go off on all these tangents. Matthew chapter, but it's all good. I really believe it's all good. I'm feeling good. Some of you I know might not be feeling good right now. In Jesus' name, I want you to feel good. Some of you are like kind of sideways with the program. In Jesus' name, get on the track right now. I'm going to jack you up here in a minute, get you turned.
Amen.
Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, it's my assignment. And maybe some of you don't know it. People get out there just think, oh, he translated the Bible. They get weird about this. No, it's my assignment. It's a divine assignment that I have, witnessed by many people around me who are called of God to take his word into all the earth. And so I'm just doing what I'm supposed to do. And I want you to profit from it, because all we want is to know exactly what God said. Not so we can feel like, oh, we got a better idea of it all, a better understanding of it all. Don't we just go do it all? And this is one of the verses of scripture that is one of the many verses just of scripture that just stand out in a radical way. And I hope that I wrote it down. I did. Matthew 28:20. Teach them to obey everything that I have commanded you. You know, if I underline that right there, if I stop there, it is very different from a modern concept of teach. Because what Jesus taught was something that you do. Like signs, wonder, miracles, deliver them, cast out devils, heal the sick, raise the dead. Go out there, face whatever's in front of you. You're going to win. They're going to take you into their synagogues and they're going to beat you. That's pretty radical. This is what he taught them to do. Let me show you how to get persecuted. Just bring heaven to earth. Here's what he taught them to do. To bring heaven to earth. To bring the power of God and put it on display before humanity. And what we've done is turn religion into it. Just sit around and think about it. How many verses of scripture can you quote? Oh, you can quote more than me. Wow, you're more spiritual. No. The word of God is powerful. It's living. It's not for us to sit around in a think tank about. Well, if you're in a think tank, you're actually supposed to do something with it. Here in San Diego, they actually had the Human Genome Project right here in San Diego. All 1 billion base pairs was pretty much sequenced right here. What are we doing? It really should put a fire underneath us. They have taken what they know and they have gone to incredible heights with it. We take what we know and sit around and feel sad with each other, condemned or whatever else. Are you listening? Come on, people. Let's find another gear here, because we in the low one and the transmission burning out. We're trying to go faster than this low gear can go. Come on, people. Let's just shift it into high gear over here and let God take us somewhere, even if it costs us our life. Because I tell you, if it costs you your life, you're going to die great. Amen. You'll immediately go from whatever tragedy you were facing right into the glorious presence of God, seeing Father stand there with his arms stretched out, smiling at you. He said, come over here. Let me hug you. I believe that with all of my heart. I see him. He's right here with me. teaching. I want to teach you, and so I'm going to get after this. And people saying, why are you so passionate about it? I'm going to tell you right now, blame my father. Blame the Holy Ghost. He's the one who did this to me. I'm passionate about what he said we're supposed to be doing in this earth as a city set upon a hill, a light that cannot be that shines that cannot be hid. And he describes it always in terms of what he himself is doing right now alongside of us. But only does it, but only will manifest it through us. The invisible Jesus is with us right now. But he will only manifest himself to people as we cooperate with him and let him do it through us. The Holy Spirit comes upon us, is with us to activate something on the inside of us, which becomes the surge of rivers of what only he can do. Amen. But he's got to have somebody believe him. I would like to believe that if we were the ones that were there on that day, on the day of Pentecost, the first day, 2,000 years ago, that we would have had the same response that they did. And one of the ways we can prove that is that we do it right now. We do it right now. That we replicate what they did. But because the increase of his government, there is no end, it will be bigger than what it was then. It'll be more widespread. But it's never going to happen until there's boots on the ground. Until people are walking the sidewalks. Until people are demanding some things. Reaching in and grabbing a hold in the realms of faith. Those things which God has spoken, which can never change, can never be altered, that will always come to pass in the life of somebody who will believe him. Amen. Period. There's going to be all kinds of excuses for you guys now. And I'm sure you're well familiar with them, well acquainted with them, so I don't need to review it. But someday you're going to, and I pray it's today, that you rise up and go, no! No more! I've died and gone to heaven. I'm crucified with Christ Jesus. I'm going to learn what it means to deny my own will, deny my own self-interest, deny my own thinking, deny my own ideas about how life works, and start believing what God said about how life works. Hallelujah. And what I'm supposed to be doing with this precious life that he gave us. Listen, he shaped us in his own image and his own likeness. That's powerful right there to say, I know what God looks like. I'm looking at you. Well, he renewed us. The scripture said in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24. He renewed us in that image of his likeness. In righteousness and true holiness. So that means every one of us have been given the power and the ability to behave, to act, to feel, to move, to think just like he does right now. That we love like he loves, we joy like he joys, we peace like he peaces, we mercy like he mercies, we forgive like he forgives, we move in power and signs and wonders and divine authority just like he does. As many as received him, he gave to them authority to be the sons. If you just stopped right there, went through the Bible and said, let me list every description of what it means to have the authority of the Son. The definition of the Son of God. Because sonship is only defined within the framework of the only begotten Son. That's just John 1:12. God's opening this up. He's saying, in the beginning was the Word. And people are all excited because they got the right orthodoxy. But when it comes to verse 12, somehow the orthodoxy broke down and there is no orthopraxy. Somehow we're too interested with this worldly thing, that earthly thing, this care, that concern, this pleasure, that prosperity. And he said, yeah, you've been born again. It's just the cares of this life and deceitfulness of riches and pleasures of this world has choked the word. You'll plant. You know, you can go in there, you can go in there with a hoe. It's pretty violent. You go into a tree that's been choked, can't bring forth fruit, get violent with the pruning. Hooks, are you with me? And saws and shears. I feel like I'm doing it almost every morning that I preach. Get the hoe, start just pulling at that grass. if you were a living organism that had a mouth, you'd be going, ouch, oh, oh, I can't, this isn't love. You're hurting me. You stripped most of me away. I've got one trunk and one branch left. Yeah, but this thing can grow. Because we got rid of all the weeds, and we fertilized you, and we got rid of all the dead bark and all the sucker vines, sucker branches. Now you're ready. And then you got somebody around you, and so weeds start to grow, and it's like they're coming at you with a hoe. So if you feel like I'm coming at you with a hoe this morning, you understand what's going on. If I got a pruning saw, you can feel something grinding. That's what's going on. We want you to bring forth fruit. The husbandman says, no, don't tear it out. Give me one more chance. The shepherd says, give me one more chance. Let me prune it. Let me dig around it and fertilize it. Perhaps this year, it'll bring forth fruit. I'm believing God for something great in the year 2024, not only in San Diego, but Kashmir, Japan. Japan will explode this year. Japan will explode this year. The foundation that has been laid. I mean, I already got my eye on 100 acres that's right beside of us. I see the expanse already going on. People are going, slow down. We got to pay for what we got. Listen, it's already paid for, man. I mean, the bank doesn't know it yet, but as far as I'm concerned, me and God have had a conversation and it's paid for. We're moving on now. Let the bean counter sit in the room and bite their nails. For us, we're moving on. More things in God. He's God or he's not. We can step out to the nth degree of believing him and expecting that what will happen is those things that only God can do. Or we'll sit in the realm of what we think we can accomplish along with God because we're reading the Bible. No, you got to push this, man. Anytime I feel like letting up, I grab a hold of myself. You listen here, buddy. We're moving this thing forward. Yesterday, I told Ann, I said, yeah, well, you know, I praise God for the time that we get to kind of rest up and relax, but I'm rested now. Let's go. Hallelujah. Let's do this. Come on, people, let's do this. Here's what he promised. This, if you just had this one verse of scripture, and that's all God left us is this one verse of scripture, how far do you think you could go with this? When he says, we have one verse of scripture, we've got some notion or idea, really, of who he is and what he did, and he said to us, teach them to obey everything that I've commanded you and realize, listen to this, this is it. This is powerful. This is almost exactly word for word. I could say it is word for word. And realize that I am with you every day. Not always. They left out the day. Hey, sir, time out. You left out a very important word here, the day, every day. And literally, I could say, in translating this, every day, all day. Wow, what happens when somebody believes that? I mean, I can sit here and stand here, rather, I'm not sitting, stand here and talk about the mutual indwelling and spit all over the place and get my veins popping out of my neck and get all, you know, dramatic. Every day, but until you'll do those things that God has commanded us to do, you will never truly realize the mutual indwelling. And the mutual indwelling, because mutual indwelling will never really truly be understood by you or believed by you until you step out and start doing what only God can do. Because that's what it's all about. About a new creation that can now represent the kingdom of God and bring heaven to earth. That's the whole message of Jesus. That's the state we find ourselves in because of the fallen sin of Adam. But look at what God has done for us through the final and last word. The last Adam, his only begotten son. He brought all heaven to earth, erased all the power of Satan, and now has charged and commanded you and I to go in his authority, to go with his power, to understand how he does it. He defines sonship for us so that we can get it. Son could do nothing of himself. He and then applies it to us from John 5, 19 and 20, and takes us right over there into John 15, 6, and says, you can do nothing without me. You can do nothing of yourself. And he's telling us, listen, I want to show you how close I am to you. It's like a vine inside, a branch inside of a vine. I'm the vine, you the branch. I'm telling you, Father God, our Holy Father, our Heavenly Father is one ten in us. I'm telling you, he's going to produce big grapes. Amen. Lots of fruit. I saw a picture of some horticulture that was going on with grapes in Israel. The clusters were like, talk about Canaan land. And they were big, and a lot of, you know, those bigger grapes, they sour. Supposedly these things are super sweet. I didn't have one. But can you imagine eating a grape like a grape that's like an apple or big as a plum at least? Ooh. Come on. They got the right husbandman working on that vine. Father's the one tending this thing because he wants us to produce fruit. And the fruit that he wants us to produce is that whatever we ask him, he will do it. He wants to produce and nurture such a relationship, such an agreement, that whatever we ask, he's totally in. Samuel spent enough time before the presence of the Lord that he knew how to properly represent Father. He got a hold of Father's ways, his mind, his thoughts about things, so that Father did not let one single thing he said fall to the ground without it being fulfilled. It just wasn't empty words. Every one of those words were fulfilled. And in many respects, I just think it was things that he felt to do. Okay, let's do this. Okay, this is going to happen. Because we just step out, we get bold with God, huh? And then you just recognize, wait a minute, I recognize he's on the inside of me. I'm going to boldly speak. Here's what's going to happen next. And Father's going, woohoo, we're going to do that. I'm going to see how much, I'm going to see how far I can take you in this. We're going to bring you up to the past the 12th hour, the final hour. And where you just saying, it's all good, it's going to be fine. Everybody's like, we're going to die. We're going to lose it all. That's fine. Because I believe God. I trust him with my life. I trust him with my eternity. I'm prove him. Prove me. God says, prove me. He's all about provision. Prove me. It's more than just provision financially, materially. It's provision supernaturally to be who he said we are. To do what he said we could do. To present him to the people that are so important to him. That he sent his only begotten son to die such a cruel death so that the punishment for sin and the power of iniquity could be absolutely and totally broken. How much does he love them? How much does he love the obnoxious person that is standing in front of you telling you they don't believe in God and you know they do? Because you're not buying no lies. And everything coming out of their mouth primarily is a deception that Satan has taught them. So you know who you are, you know in whom you believe, and you're going to tell them who they are and what God will do for them. Ooh, you start speaking faith. You start speaking God's word, you're speaking faith. Now you passionately all in. Everything about you is all in. You spend enough time talking to him that he's dealt with all your doubts, all your uncertainties, all your fears, all your weakness, all your timidities. That's what prayer is about, people. Yeah. Pop, Father, teach you how to talk. Once you learn how to talk to him, Holy Ghost, teach you how to talk to Father. Once you learn how to talk to Father, ooh, you'll talk on his behalf from there on in. That's what a priest is. Amen. A priest comes and presents the people to God, and then he goes out and presents God to the people. That's what prayer does. That's the inner chamber of prayer and intercession. Oh, Holy Ghost, teach me how to talk to the King. Holy Spirit, teach me how to talk to the Father, the creator of the heavens and the earth, who created all things by the word, who became his only begotten son. You can have all the good doctrine you want until you put it into action. It means nothing. It's like you having all the information, you know all the secrets of the world, but you don't tell anybody. Or you have all the secrets of the world, you know the secrets of the universe, you know how to give everybody free energy for the rest of their life, but you're a mute. And do anybody any good? Not you, not anyone else. In fact, that would be misery. Have all the answers for humanity's problems, and you can't speak and you can't communicate it. Come on, people. God chose that the communication of the kingdom of God, the gospel, would be brought forth or communicated by the foolishness of declaration, the foolishness of preaching. Ooh, come on. Will you be a fool for him? Not a fool at all, spiritually, in truth. But by the world will look at you and go, you're foolish. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing here in this place. That you're going to raise up a bunch of people here so full of Holy Spirit compassion that they can't sit home at night and watch Barney Miller. I don't even know if he's still running or not. Or Andy Griffith. Or the Rifleman. Or whatever was your whatever. Favorite whatever. I know, I mean, it's like media movies more demonized now. More demonized. People want to see more murder, more bloodshed. Kids are being trained. They sit around and think about it. I heard the other day that one person was telling me, was told by a pediatrician that the bone density of the youth is worse than it's ever been. They're just sitting around. They got carpal tunnel from the joystick or whatever it is, playing the video games. Huh? I was thinking, man, if there was ever a contest, country boy meet city boy, forget about it. They lost before we got started. Are you listening to me? Sitting around is going to spiritually make you absolutely worth nothing, spiritually. You ain't going to be worth anything. I mean, God still loves you, but as far as kingdom goes, you ain't worth nothing. As a country boy say, you worthless as a tits on a boar hog. Just to break it down. You don't know what a boar hog is? That's a male hog. It's a wild hog. I know that's pretty radical. Say here in this sanctified situation. Well, I'm just telling you right now, I'm trying to break it down for you. No politics included. I'm Father still love you. I believe you make heaven. I was so blessed the other night. It's last Sunday night. I was praying with the Lord, power of God, strongest I've ever felt it ever in my life, or as much as ever in my life. And I knew that she was either going to be immediately before the morning raised up, or that she was going to go all the way up. And she went all the way up. She's in heaven. I mean, I just love, you know, maybe people don't listen to everything you got to say. Maybe not even half what you got to say. But I just love the witness from heaven that says, no, she's mine. I'll take her. I'm going. And for me, I mean, if I was in the place, you want to get healed or go up, I don't know. I'll probably go with the go up. But I mean, that's one of the things you'll hear me emphasize over and over again. People, being overweight is a disease state. It's unhealthy. Okay, take care. Believe in divine health and put some action to it. How you eat, what you do, how you exercise, how you sleep. Come on. Take care of yourself, in other words. Obey natural laws as God has ordered them to be. And walk out divine health. I'm not going to be sick a day in my life in Jesus' name. Don't get overweight, because you can get into a disease state quicker than, huh? And then anytime I start talking to you about it, all of you give me this offended look. Some of you don't. Some of you are like, yes, go, Pastor, go. There's people on the internet go, man, I praise God that somebody's talking about people's health. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But there's spiritual application. I bring it up just because there's spiritual application. You just can't just sit around spiritually and do nothing with all the good food you're eating. You got to exercise. You got to exercise. The men of God that mentored me said the spiritual growth and development is much like physical growth and development. You have to eat good food, right food. Then you have to exercise. And you have to get rest. Prayer is the rest. Exercise is moving in obedience to God. Hallelujah. The food is the word. Come on, people. You can't just sit around and stuff yourself full of food. No rest, no exercise. Just try that. See what the person is going to look like inside of Not many months. That ain't going to look good. Don't do that. I got many more things to say about that, but I'm going to leave it. It's a big deal to me. Walking in divine health is a big deal to me. Glorifying God in my body is a big deal to me. He put it right there on the same level of glorifying Him in my spirit. It's a big deal to me. Oh, but I pray it'll be a big deal to you too. Oh, listen to Mark 16:20. We're not going to go till 3:45 or 3:15. Don't you just love Britt and Audrey? Aren't they just amazing? He's just amazing. So glad we got him here. We're just going to start having him here more. And the whole family. It's true. I love all the partnerships that God has given to us. You know, it looks like Carlos and Maria Anacondia are going to come just vacation out at our house. I promise you they'll come preach as well. You know, Carlos is 79 years old this year. He's getting ready to turn 80. And he looks so healthy and fit. And he's just run wide open with the gospel, preaching almost every day of his born-again life. Ooh, so beautiful. Wow, how healthy you would be. Your life's so full, so free. To see one person brought into the kingdom every day, to vow yourself and commit yourself that you're going to talk to at least one person every day by the Holy Spirit. Set that as a part of it. God, it has to be. Because he's with us. He's working alongside of us. Look here at Mark chapter 16, verse 20. And I want to get more into this partnership as co-inheritors, co-laborers together with God. Wow. Later, today, in the afternoon meeting. But I want to just underscore these things to you quickly. Mark 16, 20 said, and they went out everywhere preaching, the Lord working with them. What a partnership. I'm never going to go out on the street into a nation, anywhere, talk to someone on the airplane or wherever I'm at without first recognizing, Jesus, you're here. Thank you, Lord, for being here. People, there's too many things. You can get into a state of self-reliance so much that you're doing this on your own. You're figuring it out in your own thoughts and your own mind. You never turn to him and begin to interact with him because he's right here. Holy Spirit is right here. He's right here. And you say, you got a pressing issue? Lord, what should I do? Lord, show me. I thank you that you're going to show me. Lord, I know that you're here right now. And you got this drawing towards a person. I'm going to go minister to them. I know Jesus is with me right now. I'm going to go, thank you, Lord, for empowering me. Thank you for touching them. As I talk to them, I thank you, Heavenly Father, that it's your spirit, your very own spirit, right now on the inside of me, giving me words. Just begin to do this in partnership and stop doing it on your own, and you're going to have an entirely different result, and you're going to have an entirely different scale of growth, if you would. rapidity of growth. Hallelujah. Stop doing your stuff on your own, in Jesus' name. And he was with him. And establish the word through the miracles that followed. Hallelujah. I like them when they follow immediately, but I've had many times where they followed days, weeks later. Huh? I know I was with, and this kind of, don't do this, you can't do this until you mature a little bit. But there was some, I was on an airplane, some girls got around me. They were younger girls, and they were captivated by Jesus in me. And they wanted to take a picture with me. They didn't want to hear too much about Jesus. They were New Agers. And so I took a picture with them. And I put my arm around both of them with one purpose. Power of God touched them. They'll never be the same. It's an entirely different life. It's an entirely different way of living. Entirely different way of thinking. When you know that there are going to be a miracle is going to follow every interaction you have with every person. Whether it was immediate or whether it's later. Hallelujah. They got touched by the power of God, I promise you. I can see it happening right there. I'm not interested in anything but their soul. Hallelujah. And you'll know whether that's in your life or not based upon what goes on in your thoughts. Huh? And when those things are subdued because compassion of Jesus Christ has overwhelmed you with the eternal condition of their soul more than anything else, whether you're going to be a helper to make for them to make heaven or not, the dynamics of interaction totally change. Thank you, Father, for your love. Just to grab this. Just to grab the reality. Jesus said, it's expedient for you that I go away, because if I go not away, the Comforter cannot. If I go not away, the Comforter cannot come. I have to go so that the Comforter can come, so that your Parakletos can come. And I see him, and you need to see him just like Jesus was to the disciples. I want you to see him just like Jesus was to Peter, James, and John. They got to go everywhere with him. And no way I'm going to be set back by the fireplace when he says, Peter, James, and John, come with me. I'm like, time out. Hold up. I'm out. I'm crushed. I'm getting ready to start sobbing right now. Just tell me what I got to do. And everybody sat there silent. What? Peter, the big mouth, and the two sons of thunder. It's true, the big mouth and the two sons of thunder. They got to go. There was something passionate about them you'll see it in their life. Hallelujah. Peter basically got himself in constant trouble by saying things off top of his head. But when he got rebuked, he took it good every time. Oh, okay, I won't say that anymore. Okay, got it. He's in. He never took offense. I'm waiting that day where I get to see all the miracles and signs and wonders of James. It wasn't recorded, but he had to be the most radical of them all because they had to kill him first. This guy's going to turn everybody to Jesus. We're going to lose a high priest. Even the high priest is about to repent because of James. Come on. Let's get in the race for this. Let's get in the running for this. You find this on your face going, oh God, oh God. And I can't be as passionate right now as I'm going to bust people's eardrums and freak people out. But there's a place you can cry out to God. Joshua's a big old guy now, but when he was this big, I'd carry him around by his little legs. Because especially when he was having a little problem or whatever, stomach ache or crying for some reason. And those legs kept getting bigger. I'd lay his stomach right here, and I'd walk around, and he got to be a part of my everyday prayer. And I promise you people, I get loud. I get really loud. Because what happens, I get a river. And I don't know how to be quiet with a river yet. I haven't been trained. Some of you might, I don't know where you got your training. But I tell you right now, I get a sound coming out of me that can bring down the walls of Jericho. Especially when there's a troop all doing it with the same resonance. Ooh, That's how he grew. Right over, strapped up. I mean, there'd be times nothing could get him comforted. He'd get something in his little mind and he'd scream louder. And he had an endurance that was amazing. But I'd lay him over my shoulder or carry him around. And when I got to hollering the loudest in the Holy Ghost, kaboom, he was KO'd, completely out. So knocked out in sleep. Why? Because of the glory. What would trouble people who have demons? What would trouble people who have a God of indecision? Because it's just too loud for me. Put him to sleep. Put him to bed. I want you to just grab a hold of that which God wants to do in your life. As you give yourself to talking with him about the things that he's purposed to do through you. Not all about the bad things you've done to him, but about the things he wants to do for you and through you. Come on. Faith realm. Huh? Faith realm is I'm pure. Mm-mm. I'm holy. Mm. Righteous and acceptable. He was made a sin offering for me that I might be made the righteousness of God in him. That I could be a pleasing sacrifice, a sweet aroma. I smell better than the frankincense that was offered with every offering of peace. I smell the smell of the sweet aroma of Jesus in my Father's presence. Come on, get yourself right. Get out of the condemnation. Get into the reconciliation. Hallelujah. Get out of, draw not nigh into the place of holy and acceptable. Things are going to get good for you. Father said to Moses in Exodus 3:12, I'll be with you. I'm with you. Go, do the impossible. To Joshua, Deuteronomy 31:23, as I was with Moses, I'll be with you. Jeremiah 1:8, I'm with you. I put my words in your mouth. Doesn't matter what they say. They're going to take you. I'll put my words in your mouth. I'm with you, but they're going to throw you in a pit. That's okay, I'm with you in that pit. It's going to turn out good throughout the ages. Because your word will be, your word, what I will speak through you, will either bring the results of their eternity with me or the clear evidence for, before them for all eternity that I pleaded with them. I did not want any of them to perish. You carry that responsibility. We carry that responsibility, every person, that we withhold this expression of the Holy Spirit, who alone can declare who Jesus is, not you and me, him. You must first receive power from on high. Then you can be witnesses unto me that I'm alive, and you can be witnesses of the resurrection, the power that changed everything, the power unto eternal life. First, you need to be baptized. What does baptism result in? Being filled. You should be baptized not many days hence. What took place? And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, are those two words equated? The results are. The Holy Ghost came upon them, fulfilling that which the prophet Joel, not fulfilling, but bringing to pass, at least in a big part, that which the prophet Joel had spoken. Shall come to pass in the last day, saith the Lord. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and you shall prophesy. You will speak by the Spirit the things that only Father can declare. Ooh, ooh. Everybody stand with me. Come on. In Jesus' name. Come on. You either in or you in doubt. You either in and doing it, or you still in doubt. And we want not a single person that is under the sound of our voice. That's me, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost standing right here, right now. That's under the sound of our voice to be left out, to be left in doubt, to be left in unbelief. Jesus knows what's going on. Holy Spirit knows what's going on. Holy Spirit knows what's going on. He knows the hurts of your heart that you're holding on to that He wants you to release. He knows. The pains, the agonies, the wrong desires, demonic influence that's going on. He wants that all to be broken off of you. He wants you to walk in the same freedom of love, peace, joy, goodness, compassion, care that He Himself expresses, because you and I were recreated in His image, in His likeness. In His own righteousness, in His own holiness, which is only going to be demonstrated, understood, and expressed in love. Let me just tell you something, people, here, because you need this. And you need this because you need to get hungry for the things of God if they're not realized in your life. He that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. This is the mutual indwelling. It's proof of it. You know, all the way from the very beginnings of the radical statements of John 6:56 of Christ in us, that he's in us and we're in him, to the expression, the radical declaration of 1 John 4 that I just quoted, he that dwells in love dwells in God, God in him. And boy, over and again, the mutual indwelling is highlighted, that he's in us and we're in him. But people, there is a proof and evidence, there is a fruit. There are the fruits of the Spirit, but then there's the fruit of relationship of John 16, 15. You want that. There's no condemnation here. It's just like, hello, it's an invitation. But what gets me is when people nod their head yes, and I don't see the invitation having been responded to. Oh, yeah, I'm there. No, you're not. I'm at the party. I don't see you yet. We're on the phone with you. Are you with me? We want you to come to the party. We want you to be, and no one can do this for you except for the Father. The invitation comes to you, but it's your response, not to me, but to Him. Of whether or not you're going to obey Him. It's not, listen, can I may help you? You're not going to realize this sitting in your living room. You're going to get touched by it when you're in the meetings. But ultimately, it is going to be fulfilled in you and fully realized in your life and developed in your life as you obey, as you go. Like, that's what He said to His disciples. Are you a disciple or not?
Yes.
Go into all the world and preach the gospel. He told us, but first be endued with power from on the high. Then you shall you be witnesses unto me. I'm doing this. I'm going to do this. It's been my heart cry when I was a young minister. I'm like, oh, Lord, please help me to get connected rightly with people in missions all over the world so that we have a means to send people all over the world. And I never realized what God would do. It's far bigger than I ever thought or asked. But ultimately now, this partnership that we have, this alliance that we have with so many great missions ministries. And it's just a resolve, people. It's a surrender. Surrender. And I'm going to once again refer here to David Hogan this afternoon. Because everybody that came to him that wanted to be a part of Freedom Ministry, he'd look at them and demand of them, how many people have you already reached and brought into the kingdom where you come from? And how many people have you set in your heart to reach going forward? Because those are salient questions about where your heart is, of whether or not you even belong in a ministry. You're not qualified to be in ministry unless you are passionate about the lost. So passionate that you're going. Otherwise, these people, give me a lapel. No. Nobody can give you a lapel. And I'm so blessed by what God is doing to you, Jason, KC, and your family. I look at the boys, I'm going, look at these preachers, man. They all queued up. And they learn in Urdu. You know, Hamza told me the other day, sent me a voicemail, I believe it was. I can't remember his voicemail or text. And he said, oh, I was listening to Spirit songs. And he was telling me a particular song he was listening to. And then he told me a particular rare dialect in Hindi that I was speaking. And then I started looking up on the map because, oh my goodness, I'm speaking in this particular dialect. And it's the whole region, the whole state that Mumbai is in. And do you know that dialect of Mumbai, that area? It's Maharia or Maharishi or something like this, a unique dialect. It's known as, And I was saying, Jesus is real. Jesus is real. I'm singing it. Tons of men and angels. He said, you also said some things in Urdu, but it was primarily we're just declaring Jesus in Urdu. I'm like, let me go back and listen to Spirit Songs 1. Yeah, the tongues of men and angels. I'm thinking, okay, add that to the list. I thought we were only going to go to Mumbai to pick up things that were being shipped in. There's going to be more. And I started getting the map out, flying around, looking at all the different little towns and all the different stuff. Lots of wild animals, lots of tigers there. The Lord's big kitty cats. The Lord likes them. That's why He created them. He thinks they're cool. He has no reason to be afraid. I know some missionaries, I could tell you their names, I'm going to leave it though. But the witch doctors had sent out 2 lepers to kill them. And when they leaped off of the rock, to attack them as they were walking to the next village. Lightning came out of it and struck them dead right at their feet. True story. God's a good shot. Bam. Hallelujah. Today we're just calling you to come over here and live. And we're calling you to come and do what? And live what you believe. Calling you to come believe. Amen. Faith declared to you. Your action is saying, yes, Lord, I'm in. From this day forward, doesn't matter who says what. If the government was to stand up in San Diego today and say, there's no more preaching in the street, I'll be preaching in the street. We're going to take you to jail. If you come try to knock on anybody's door, you're going to jail. There wasn't enough of us that got arrested during COVID. They arrested people for preaching Jesus, standing in line at the DMV, getting in the door. And there's somebody there full of the Holy Ghost going, let me just tell you about Jesus. And they came and they arrested him. Somebody went and complained. He's breathing on me. He's violating the COVID rules. Right now, it's wide open, people. Let's go do it. Make God bigger than you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. This day, God becomes bigger than you. This day, what he wants becomes more important than what you want. This day, what he's willed is more important than what you will. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And I command all sickness and all disease and all sorrow and all torment to leave you. Every oppressive thing that would try to steal from you provision and the things that you are necessary for your life, in Jesus' name, I command it to go now. Last night I looked at a picture in Summer's preaching in Oregon, and they've got the majority of the town in the meeting. It is beautiful. Hallelujah. I'm going, oh, thank you, Father, for those who are going out from us who know how to bring it, who know how to declare the gospel and live it. Hallelujah. And I pray in the name of Jesus that that's going to be every one of you. I just see everyone here pastoring different churches right here in San Diego County. 197 church plants. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the vision. Lord, we thank you that Pastor William, Pastor Jacqueline is here this morning. What you're doing through their lives in Oregon. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. What you're raising up there. And I have no hesitation of saying Pastor William and Pastor Jacqueline, because that's where they're going. They're pastoring now, and they will pastor in far greater capacities in the future. And I want to just be able to, you know, see the Lord do those special things, whatever it is he's purposed for you to do. Just go with him, because this is the best life. You'll live happy all the rest of your life. You'll spend the rest of your life rejoicing. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, thank you, Jesus, for your people. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, we'll be back here at 4. Come back at 4 for more. Worship the Lord with your giving. Just worship the Lord. Make it an offering of praise, an offering of worship, thanking him for all that he's done. Let it be tithe and let it be offering. And I promise you, God's going to work a miracle for you. And it's going to be supernatural and spectacular in every way of provision, I promise. And because he's promised. And hug everybody in the place before you go. Come back this afternoon. And if anybody needs prayer for anything, once you come, we'll pray with you and for you. If you're not sure that you're right with God, come. If you have sickness in your body, come. If you have a prayer that you need answered, someone to agree with you, concerning. Come, we'll pray with you. God will touch you. I'm absolutely certain about it. There will be heaven's provision for you when we pray. God has promised, and none of his promises can fail. He's always yes and amen. No matter what the sign says, he's yes and amen. If the stop sign says stop, you go, no. God said go. It's yes and amen. What's up?